Hi guys, Lady Random here, and welcome back to Crackback. Okay, I am on my own for the first part of this episode, but we will be doing something a little bit later on with Olvra. She's going to show us something rather exciting and also rather dangerous, from what I understand. And I think Gollum here is having an absolute wild of a time bouncing on the bed. He seems to be really obsessed with doing this, but, you know, bless him. But basically what I want to do, just for the first part of this episode, is just show you sort of how I'm getting on with the homework that we got set. Probably remember we were set a few weeks back some homework on bees, and that was to get ourselves to cultivated bees. And then in the last episode where we did some Thorncraft, we were set some homework to create our infusion altar, and quite a lot of other stuff actually, which, to be honest with you, we haven't got particularly far with. But I thought, well, let's have a look and see where we've got to so far. So, if you remember, we'd set up a few things here. We set up our alchemical furnace and the arcane alembic. We've set up some of our warded jars. We've got our crucible set up. We got our thormic robes and bits like that. That was all done. And we were busy sort of starting to create stuff, a little bit of lag again, there we go, for making the infusion altar. So we learned how to make arcane stone. So hopefully we won't suffocate in the block going down here, it seems to happen. But, ta-da! One infusion altar. Now, it wasn't without its issues. I think I built it and rebuilt it about three times and was sitting there and right-clicking with my wand to try and activate the runic matrix to finish it off, and it wasn't working. The one thing that I'd kind of overlooked was the fact that I actually needed to have enough energy in each of the wands, which I didn't have. So again, Olvra very kindly came over and she activated it for us, but that is one part of our homework done. So with regards to the other bits that we've actually got, we have our research notes for Boots of the Traveller. So we'll need to make those. We do have, if I can actually find my Thormonomicon. Is that it right? Where were we looking? We're looking at Artifice, I think. Ooh, a bone bow. That sounds exciting. Is it an Artifice? Yes, there we go. So Boots of the Traveller, we want to make those. Made our enchanted fabric. We also want to, I think this must be the girdle. The magic mirror, we've actually already got one of these that Olvra made for us already. Not that we're actually going to be doing that sort of straight away. But yeah, so our Boots of the Traveller, and what's this here? The runic shielding. Ooh. Interesting. Interesting. But yeah, Boots of the Traveller is one of the things, so we will need to do the research for that coming up. So that is that. And oh, I suppose we didn't really say the room. So I've used Valentine's blocks for this, just to make it a little bit girly, a little bit pretty. I do need to come up with something for the ceiling. Plus also, I think, sort of as Olvra said, we probably will need to actually expand this room very slightly. So maybe I'll take it out, I don't know, a couple of blocks sort of further in each direction. So I'll need to redo the walls. But again, you know, that's something that I can have a go at later on. So yes, there we go. That is that. Let's put our Thormonomicon back. And there, Alexa. Yeah, see, our wand's a little bit low. In fact, both of them are a little bit low. So yeah, we do need to go out, do a little bit more node hunting. I've had to reinstall the launcher. I was having a few issues, unfortunately, with loading things up. And I still can't get Curse to work. I still don't know why. But hey, it is what it is. But yeah, it does mean I lost all of my waypoints with all of the nodes that I found, which is a little bit frustrating. So I'll have to start kind of recollecting those. We obviously know that we've got our Terra and Ignis one over there, and we've got, I think it's Terra and Air here. But as you can see, many, 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 many flowers. We've also started to get some pollination of the trees happening as well, which is cool. So lots going on. I've made a automated wheat farm over here, as you probably remember. In fact, we'll pop over here anyway because there was something else over here to show you. You should probably remember we were using this here field as our source of seeds, which was a little bit small. Sorry, little chicken, but you need to die. Oh, there we go. Well, you're out. That's fine. That works for me. Yeah, we were trying to use this. We did put a harvester in, but we're having a bit of trouble with the planter, in so much as the planter wanted to plant outside of the field with the upgrade. And I really wanted to have the upgrade on there. But this is just kind of a basic manual wheat field. It just gives us a little bit of extra wheat that we can use there with the animals if we want to. But yeah, I can always collect the seeds up, which is good. We've made over here our coke oven. So now we can make charcoal. So we've got a nice sort of sustainable thing without mining up loads of coal and everything like that. So we can now make charcoal, which will be useful for the Thorncraft stuff, as you know. That's, I don't sleep because it just give the bees a bit more chance. There we go. So yes, yeah, so that means that we've got an automated wheat farm that I've built now, which now has the harvester that I had previously over there, which has its full upgrade in it, and that's been powered by a solar panel there. And then we have our planter underneath here, which has been powered by that solar panel. It's enough. It's only a solar panel one, but it's plenty enough just to keep that ticking over quite nicely. I could have wired the two together, but quite frankly, I couldn't be bothered. It's kind of a little bit of a quick fix. I have got a lily pad of fertility just to try and speed the growth up a little bit. That is, it's fairly awkward to make in a way, I suppose. Lily pad of fertility, there you go. So in that you need a lily pad, you need splash fertilizer serum, and that's made up with condensed splash serum and bone meal. And the condensed splash serum is basically a vial of ordinary water, nether wort, and gunpowder, and your vial of ordinary water. To be honest with you can make your empty vials just with 5 panes of glass, and you can go and manually fill them just from a nearby lake or sort of infinite spring. But yeah, so I did make one of those, and I'm actually use all my gunpowder. Oh, down the oil. But yeah, this is ticking over quite nicely, and it took a little while to get to a point where we were actually in credit, as it were, with the seeds. But we are now at that point, so it ticks over. It's busy planting and replanting. I've left a little entrance way here that gives us access to our planter, which means that we have got the ability to grab the seeds that we actually need at the time. So we'll take that every time I get a stack. It's at that point I'm actually grabbing them and getting them into our squeezer in order to make our impregnated sticks. I believe it's impregnated ones. There we go, let's whack those in there. Hopefully I'll actually get up to 100 and actually make us a couple. 90, 100, there we go. So our impregnated sticks, perfect. So that means that we can carry on making the frames that we actually need. I am running low on string, but that's all good because I have got the cotton going for there we go. That's another 10 there. Lovely jubbly. So yeah, I have got the cotton growing there. So that's all good. What I've also wired up to this, so the seeds are sent out via an EndryO item conduit out to the planter. They've got a whitelist for that on there. The wheat comes into this buffer chest here. That then feeds into this auto workbench, which is set to make bread. It's just about to make another one. Let's throw that in there as well. So that now makes bread, which feeds back into this chest here. So ultimately, no wheat sits in here. You can see it just goes in and goes straight out again. But it just acts as a little bit of a buffer in case this does decide to go crazy. But I don't think it will. But yeah, so we have a nice, easy food source happening there as well. So win-win, methinks. So back to the bees. The bees. So you probably saw I've now set up caches. So we've got our meadows drones and meadows queens in here. So all of the stabilized drones basically go into this cache and we pull out the honeycomb into this one. Same for the forest here. We'll set up another one for our common. So that's ticking along quite nicely, but those are running out. We've lost one up there, so we do need to make some more frames. But that's fine. And this little butte here is the start of our breeding to try to get our cultivated bees. Now, Ulva was really generous, and she has given us an absolute stack of rock hives, which gives us the ability to get the rocky princesses, which we can use with the common drones to make our cultivated drones. Now, this one's not brilliant. It's a fast worker, which is good. So I'm thinking we might use that to actually speed things up eventually. The one I'm trying to use at the moment is trying to get the fertility up. The fertility on this one, I don't think was particularly good. It doesn't actually tell us. Let's have our bee Eliza very quickly stick those eggs in there, shall we? There we go. I think this was only like fertility one or something like that. Yeah, facility one. It has got an inactive of 3, but obviously it's inactive is common. So this is probably one where we do want to try and breed this in ultimately, but the one that we've actually got in there at the moment is a more fertile one. So hopefully that should work. So what have we ended up with? We've ended up with commons. It's commoned again. Okay, let's have a look at this drone. So that's 2 times, and it's inactive as 2 times. So hopefully that should help. And what's this little lady? She is 2 times, 2 times. Okay. So maybe what we could do now is get our slightly faster drone. That's not going to stack with those, is it? That's a rocky drone that's come out of there. So back to a rocky princess again. Let's whack this in here. So I think this is half the thing, is that trying to actually stabilize our rocky princess into a cultivated princess and start producing cultivated drones. I think this is the thing that's going to take a little bit of time. But yeah, we're getting some honeycomb out of it, which is good. So we'll take our rocky drone and our common drones. I think we could probably get away with popping them back into the cache for the moment. But let's stick our rocky drone in here out the way. Not going to be needing him just yet. So yeah, there we go. So it's a little bit of a time consuming process. So I've just been off doing this and kind of coming back and checking on it and seeing how it's going. So yeah, we're getting there. We are getting there. Okay. So kind of sort of thinking at this point, we'll make a little wee jump cut. And we'll be back in, well, it could be half an hour or so for me, but a matter of seconds for you guys with Ulva to have a look at what dangerous stuff she's doing in Thorncraft. So we'll see you in a sec. And we're back. And we are in Ulva's very, 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 very cool base to do something very interesting and, from what I understand, fairly dangerous at the same time.
I'm naughty. Yeah, I've been a bad puppy, so let's be a worse puppy. We're doing some infusion because I have a little bit of a project that I'm working on. First of all, if you look to your left, you'll see a very friendly guy over there that looks completely and utterly innocent.
Oh, completely. Yeah.
Not like he has any kind of hidden thoughts going around and weird on his head.
No, the red eyes, they're just Pure love.
Definitely.
Pure love.
Definitely. Yes, yeah, exactly that.
And he has.
But yeah, I'm doing some dabbling. I have started doing some forbidden magic. And the reason for that is, first, I needed a node that had all the different aspects in it at the same time. And that's going to take like 3 months to find if I look for it in the world.
Wow.
So I could either wait 3 months and look all the time, or I could just do one bit of research and become a little bit corrupted. So I did a little bit of research and became a little bit corrupted. So what I'm doing now is I'm making it worse. Because I'm building my small house out here, and I'm making myself a tower for Thorncraft stuff. The infusion, of course, cannot fit up there, but it has other purposes. And you can see those windows up there.
Yeah.
There's six of them. There's six blocks outside. And my intent is to place an aura node on each of them. So what we are doing is we are making artificial or synthetic aura nodes, which contains 120 vis of only a single aspect.
Wow.
So yesterday I was doing that during the stream, and I made almost all the nodes, finished it today, but one of the nodes, well, I'll show you. Let me see if I can find it. Here it is. Because I made this little fella.
Oh.
Don't click it with your wand.
Oh. Well, luckily I haven't brought my wand with me, which is probably a good thing. But that, yeah. That looks a bit naughty.
That looks very evil, right?
Mm-hmm.
This is a bright, hungry node.
Oh, now these are the things that cause all sorts of problems, aren't they?
This is the thing that killed me.
Hmm. Oh, at least it's in a
jar.
So
yeah, we will not be opening that jar ever, but we are going to have to make another Peditio node because of that. So I have prepared Essentia for another try.
Okay.
20 jars of 64 Essentia.
Wow.
A little over 1,200 Essentia for the infusion process itself. Plus the extra jar, which we're going to use to attune the node matrix.
Wow.
So, if we go in here, I have prepared some things. Over here in the arcane work table, we have the recipe for an unattuned node matrix, a jar, four greatwood logs, and Salus Mundus, which is balance shards that has been cooked to break them down.
Okay, yeah.
So if I just change into my crafting gear so that I can do it semi-cheap, then we can grab this, if I can. There we go. It's bugging a little bit, probably because we're both looking inside of it.
I think so.
Then we need to attune it. We need to take some Peditio. Eight of those, and we surround it, which gives us an attuned matrix with Peditio 8. That takes a little bit more order, almost out. Doing it again. There we go. So now we have the attuned matrix. Let's put our speedy gear back on and go out here, because now we're going to make things that are a little bit chaotic. Ooh. We're going to do infusion. And, you know, normally when we do infusion, we would like to do things like place these adjacent to or opposite of each other to make it at least somewhat stable.
Yeah.
We're not going to bother with that because this has no chance in hell of being stable. So we're going to try and make it easy. We're just going to do that and hope for the best.
Is there a safe distance to stand at, or?
No, but as long as you keep yourself in bed, you probably won't die.
I like the probably part.
I haven't died yet. You need to be extremely unlucky to be hit by that many strikes, but you might get struck by a couple of surges. I got something. I just discovered a research by having a headache.
Oh, okay.
My corruption has given me a couple of headaches and weird hungers.
Yeah,
But
you were saying about that, which is, what was it? Is it just completely changes your hunger thing and makes you really hungry sometimes, or?
it basically, if you start feeling the hunger, as long as it's not the bad hunger, it's just like eating up your, I think it eats your saturation bar instantly or something. But if you get the weird extra hunger, then it wants you to eat human flesh, and I'm not doing that.
No, no.
Apparently Tisno died when it asked him to do it because he didn't.
Oh my goodness.
I don't think it's because he didn't eat. I think he eat flesh, but I'm pretty sure you can get around it without eating flesh.
Yeah.
But otherwise I'm just gonna die because I refuse to do that.
Yeah, no, I completely get that.
But we're going to start the infusion process here, and it's going to take a couple of minutes to finish, and that gives plenty of opportunity to chaotic stuff to happen, so let's get started.
Oh dear. Oh, there we go, it's starting to draw in the Paditio, isn't it?
Yep.
Oh, and there's like lightning things.
Yeah, it is going to react a little bit violently, and probably blow up several bits of Salismundus along the way. I usually lose between 2 to 4 during the reaction from various explosions and effects.
So is this where it kind of falls off the pedestal and stuff like that as well? And
yeah, or completely destroys the item. That's why for most infusions you want to have a couple extra saved up in your inventory, just in case it destroys something. So it'll very slowly drain the essentia while we wait for things to happen.
So what could be the potential effects of this then?
Well, it usually blows up a couple of times. It surges lightning out to different sides, which can strike you or like that, knock things off the pedestals. It will also create flux and flux gases. You can see the ceiling is now completely covered in flux gases and is almost overflowing.
Wow. Oh yes, so, that sort of purpley stuff hovering.
Yep, that is flux gases.
And what does that do?
If you touch it, you get flux flu.
Oh, this is this horrible flu you were telling us about before, wasn't it?
Yep, yeah. If you... Oops, there we go, flux is forming. Honey! Grab the top of the candles. I'm not even going to bother not stepping in that because
that'll be a flux.
The other one off as well. That one actually got destroyed, it looked like. Almost 1/4 of the way through.
Yeah, so this is flux then. I'm so glad to see this.
Yeah, liquid flux. Flux comes either in liquid or gas form.
Or both, in this instance.
Well, usually it only comes in one sort at a time, but you'll usually see both in a reaction like this. And then there's a bunch of stuff to clean up afterwards. Okay, we just passed the quarter mark. Oh, there's the gases. I'll knock both of them off this time.
Oh wow, look, it's starting to fill up like all over the pedestals and everything, isn't it?
Yep. For some weird reason, when there's a jar up here, the gas doesn't spread properly, so it just stays on top of the thing. It's also because I have a nitre over top.
So it's blocking its path. That's good.
Yeah. So we'll just sit there, so actually blocking the pedestal now, so I can't use it. But yeah. We have 825 essentia left.
So I've got all of this to look forward to then, right?
Well, this is a thing that you will do if you want to mess with forbidden knowledge, which I wouldn't recommend because it's kind of an arse. You know, Galt, he dabbled and infected our friend T. Snow.
Is he still haunted?
He's still haunted, yeah, but Galt managed to get himself so corrupted that he got three of the, I think they're called ethereal guardians, spawning on him.
Oh my god.
Which is a Thorncraft spirit of sorts.
Yeah, so this is the madness that he was talking about earlier, then, I take it.
Yeah, they will come and kick your ass, and if you get three of them, you're pretty screwed.
Yeah.
If you ever go near the obelisks and you see a ghostly visage,
yeah,
run.
Yeah, I think
he will
I have seen
the world's body, and he will hunt you down.
Yeah, they cut off in a like quite almost like rags, isn't it? It
looks
like it's wearing, and it goes all foggy and white. And yeah, I've come across one of them. There was one that was lurking, sort of a few hundred meters away from base.
Yeah, so if you get too warpy, you will start to draw such attention to you, and you will become a point for them to spawn on. Now, I have only done a couple minor forbidden knowledge things, and then the golem thing. However, the golem thing is one that is taboo knowledge.
Mm.
So that's the worst kind.
Oh, more flux.
That gives you most. Whoops. Move over here then. You feel my candles?
Nope.
Oh, that one blew up.
How are you standing in it and not getting sick?
I am sick. You can see I have small effects on me. But it's just very subtle. But yeah, I have flux flu at the moment.
And how long does that last for?
It depends how deep you stand in it. These are very like low things, so they will only give you like half a minute.
Oh, that's not so bad.
But if you submerge your body, you'll be several minutes in the stuff. Right, we're halfway through.
I love the effect of how it goes in.
Yeah, me too. The infusion is very well done.
It is, I have to say. It really is very, very clever. Very, very pretty.
Mm-hmm.
So the jars, you basically place them around the edge of the room like that, then, do you?
Yep. Oh, there's another candle that fell off. So you can see we're slowly running out of places to put things here. But we are 2/3 through the reaction now, so hopefully we won't run out. But yeah, as we progress, Owl, it's going to get more unstable because as it knocks down my candles, the reaction will become less stable. There goes one more. We'll see more effects. Oh, there goes another one.
Here's a, I've managed to pick one up that's fallen in my hand by the looks of things. Let me throw it back to you. I'm just going to throw one back to you.
Mm-hmm.
Here you
go. We have a quarter left to go now.
Yeah, oh, you're right. It's messy.
Yeah, this is one of the worst reactions you can do. It's a dangerous reaction. And it's a dangerous reaction that takes several minutes to complete, so that really creates a lot of chaos, even if it is very simple.
Yeah.
Just one fusion object and two Salus Mundus.
Oh,
it's another one. ¥240 left.
Look at all the gas.
Yep.
Oh my goodness. So how do you clean up the flux then afterwards?
It can be removed if you place a block in its place.
Okay.
So usually I go through with cobblestone afterwards and then clean it up with that. Most reactions don't create this much chaos, but this is a dangerous reaction, so
Yeah, no kidding.
make a right old mess of things. Okay, we just passed the eighth or eighth, one eighth marker. 150 left. 120 left. Oh, there goes both of them.
So do you have to get them replaced within a certain amount of time to stop it?
If you don't, it starts wasting essentia. So that's why you always want to have extra essentia saved up, not the exact amount. Because if you cannot place them, then you will run out of essentia and the infusion will become very, very chaotic, very, very fast, and that's good. So we have 20 left, 10 left, 5, 3, 2, 1, now. And the other one. And bam! Just give one last search there. We got a bright Petitio node.
Oh, now that's good.
So the difference is, so far I have managed to get, let's see, three bright nodes, two pale nodes, and one normal node, and the hungry node that's also bright. And the difference is a normal node is a normal node, a pale node recharges a little bit slower, and a bright node recharges faster.
Awesome.
So this is like the best you can possibly get, but I might want to try and make like redo the pale and the normal node so that I get six bright nodes, because now I've actually managed to get half of my nodes in bright mode, so that's very good.
That's excellent. Excellent
Now we just
work.
need to clean up this mess. I'm not going to make you watch that.
Oh, that's fantastic. Well, that was something else, wasn't it?
Yeah,
I
it's a
see.
little bit of a chaotic reaction.
Yeah, think.
Look at this mess.
Oh my goodness.
If you let this lie around, it will disappear eventually. But it might also spawn flux slimes.
Oh, okay, so are they like purple slimes, the same colour as, yeah. And I'm guessing that coming into contact with them probably isn't very good for you either.
No, they will damage you and give you flux flu, so.
Oh, well, hey, let's have one as a pet.
I don't know if they actually stick around. It wouldn't surprise me if they disappear after a while.
Yeah, they probably would despawn, wouldn't they? So. Wow. So you have to do all the same with all of the gas then as well to get rid of
Yep.
the source blocks.
Although the bit in the center, the thing under the roof, or in the roof rather, that is made so that I can actually like get the stuff without having to remove it all the time.
Okay.
So it's able to collect the gases, and then if I want to remove the gases, I can just fill it with blocks and take them out, and then it's all good again. As long as it doesn't overfill and start flowing into the rest of the room, then it's going to be a lot of ask.
Yeah, so if you're looking at it where it is now, it's sort of about half full, that's acceptable.
Yeah, and it's pretty much all coming from these node creations.
Yeah.
So if I do continue and experiment with doing the like making them all bright, it's not a person,
Madeline.
then it might just fill it up, but We'll have to wait and see.
It's quite a nice effect, though, actually, isn't it? Because the colour actually goes really well with your base.
Yeah. I was actually trying to fill it with flux. The only issue is when you have your boots of the traveller and you do this.
Uh-huh. Of course, yeah, you run up stuff, don't you?
You kind of accidentally get flux flu every now and then. So I usually try and run around the outside so I don't get that.
Yeah, that's when you're running into the crucible the other day, wasn't it?
Yep. If you don't want to run off things, you need to hold down shift, but that also slows you down, of course.
Yeah.
But yeah, that is a little bit of a chaotic infusion process for you. Something to look forward to.
Oh, absolutely.
Although you might not be doing this one exactly.
Yeah, I would say.
In fact, the ones I gave you are not that dangerous. So, yeah.
Love it. So, and your candles that you just make, is it the normal tallow candles that you use?
Yeah, and they don't get destroyed from this, so I can just replace them afterwards. I just need to make sure to pick them up.
Cool. And when
they're just coloured tallow candles, and because they're placed in a symmetrical pattern, they will help the stability of the whole process.
Cool. And do they
if you want to really... What do you say?
Do they just light when you put them down then, or do you need to light them?
No, they light by themselves. But if I really wanted to, I would only place my pedestals in the centre and then just make a circle of floating candles outside.
Okay.
But I like my place to be pretty, so...
I love the floating candles. They're very pretty.
My plan is to use them also in my house, both the normal and the floating. So, yeah.
So how do you make the floating ones then?
You take a regular candle and put an air shard inside of it.
Okay.
Basically, air shard up the bum and then you get them done.
If only it were that simple in life, eh? Oh, that's brilliant. Well, thank you so much for showing us that. That was that was really quite special and dangerous and exploding.
Yeah.
But really
it's fun to play around with. It takes a while to prepare such a reaction since you need so much essentia. But as long as you don't want to make them all bright, you don't have to do it that many times. But now that I have half of them bright, I might just try that.
Why not? Why not indeed? Okay. Well, there we go. A little bit of lag. Well, thank you all very much for watching. I hope you enjoyed that. You've definitely learnt something more than we were expecting to there. And have seen the forbidden side of things, which we probably won't be dabbling in for some considerable time. But for now... we shall see you all in the next one. Take care.